Welcome to Cycling Info and Cycling Tips. Today I'm going to be talking to Steve Hogg about bike positioning. So I met Steve Hogg around about 2000, I think
it was.
Yeah.
I would guess about 15 years ago.
And it was a time when you were writing articles for
Bicycling Australia.
Yeah, and I picked up one of your articles and I was having a lot of problems with my bike positioning.
I remember you saying at the time.
Yeah.
19 years of walking upstairs backwards.
Yeah, just... and out of all the bike fitting people that I've seen since seeing you and previous to seeing you, you're the only person that's really been able to get me back onto the bike. And I haven't found anybody locally, either in Melbourne or here in Sydney or in Adelaide, that's been able to do as good a job as you. So when I need to get my bike fit, I travel up to Sydney and I see Steve Hogg. So Steve, tell me, how did you get into bike? What's the history around getting into bike fitting?
Accident.
An accident.
I've had a lot of fairly severe injuries. I got into cycling as a 17-year-old trying to rehab from a serious knee injury. I found that the information available to me at the time didn't work for me, but I wasn't surprised by that because I had a serious injury. So I came up with something that worked. Largely forgot about that for 13 years till I found myself in a bike shop.
Right.
Then I started positioning people at first informally. I tried to use, again, the generally available information, which in those days was multiply your leg length by a number and that's your seat height, drop up a plumb line from the tibial tubercle, that's your seat setback, ball of the foot over the pedal axle, and I soon found out it didn't work.
Yeah.
I know it didn't work because from day one I wanted to judge what we did, so I did everything on a money back if not happy basis.
Right.
And when your clients want their money back, you obviously haven't done the job. So I set about looking for real answers to problems, and what I've found is there's only individual solutions to individual problems.
Right. Okay. So you've talked about seat height. You talked about angle of leg. So what have you found to be out there? What have you found to be true?
Well, at the moment, there's a big push within cycling, within large companies, Shimano, Retool, who are now owned by Specialized, BG Fitting, owned by Specialized, and others, to systematise or to attempt to systematise and formularise the relationship of a human to a bicycle. And that can never work beyond a certain point because people vary so much in what they're able to do and how they're able to do it and the individual techniques that they use. Now, that doesn't mean that people who start off in those systems are all poor fitters. Everyone has to start somewhere.
Sure.
The better ones outgrow the system they've initially been inducted into and learn how to do things in a more individual way.
So with the limitations with some of those bike systems, I mean, you've taken it, and I get that when I come up for a bike fit, it's a totally different experience to getting, you know, put through a systematized approach. So tell us about, you know, what you start working with when you see a person come into through the door.
Well, funnily enough, most of it takes place off the bike.
Right.
I mean, if anyone comes here for a fit, it's usually going to take 4 hours. If they're tricky, maybe longer. They won't get on the bike for the first 2 hours.
Right.
The first 2 hours is asking them a lot of questions designed to elicit information that'll give me little hints which may or may not be confirmed as the fit progresses. Then a fairly thorough structural and neurological assessment to find out what they can do, what they can't do, and if they can't, why they can't.
Yeah.
Now, once I'm armed with that information, I can predict with something well over 90% certainty what they'll be doing on the bike anyway and what the issues they're going to have are.
Yeah.
So the general thrust I will already know. The individual detail, we have to wait and see how they sit on the bike.
Yeah. So you get a bit of a biomechanical, structural sort of history.
Oh, much more than that.
Yeah.
I mean, where I've made a lot of headway in the last 10 years is that all modern systems and theories about bike fitting are all about quantifying movement.
Yeah.
You know, what is the angle of the knee? What is the angle of the femur to the torso? Quantifying movement, it only tells you part of the story. We should be determining the quality of the movement. Now, that's determined by central nervous system efficiency. So my approach, rather than take a pure biomechanical approach, which I think is severely flawed, I take a neurological approach. And why? Because we all want to ride a bike well. To do that, we have to function well in a biomechanical sense. We have to be efficient. But what is a precursor and determinant of that is neurological efficiency, because no muscle will fire unless a signal arrives at the right time in the muscle firing sequence. And funnily enough, I've found some little known areas of knowledge and probably stumbled over a few things myself that are new to others where you can affect how accurately the body uses neurological inputs and determines what the biomechanical result is.
Yeah. So I mean, obviously, you know, I see the level at which these systematized approaches work at a fairly common sort of level. They take a statistical...
Well, the outcome's predetermined.
Right.
You're going to be made to fit into the same 8 or 10 boxes no matter who you are and how you function. Now, maybe some of them work for you, but maybe some don't. I mean, a fit has a certain number of parameters, and what they're trying to do is put you into the average within each parameter.
Yeah.
But the more parameters there is, the less likely it is that the overall result will be a good one.
Yeah, I understand.
Because no one's average.
No one's average. I kind of liken it to, you know, fitting those systems, sort of fitting people up as if they were a 17-year-old or something like that.
There's an element of that. I think a larger problem is that they take anyone and there's no real qualification of the person. I mean, no one has to pass an exam. If you pay your money, you get your certificate. That's the biggest problem.
That's a certification for the particular bike fittings.
In many of the systems, isn't it? No, you don't have to pass an exam. You buy the equipment, you purchase the process, and wow, you've just become a bike fitter and you've done a three-day course with no exam. A guy I know who used to teach for one of the bigger systems told me if it was up to him, he'd fail 70 to 80% of the candidates, but he's not allowed to fail anyone, which is why he no longer works for that company.
That's part of the systematised approach. You really,
of course.
It's around getting yourself into a box. And, I mean, how successful is that approach? Do you see people coming in that have done fits like that?
How successful? Well, I'd say something. I track this sort of stuff, and 40 to 45% of the people that come here have been fitted elsewhere first. Now, some of them quite well, but the fine detail that makes a difference between an okay fit and a really good fit hasn't been dealt with.
Yeah.
Some of them quite poorly. So there's a wide variety in the levels of skills out there. Some people are doing quite a decent job.
Yeah.
Where they fall down is just things like missing leg length differences and also just getting the feet right, because one of the keys is getting the feet right on the pedal, both cleat position and also foot correction. And I'm sure you're going to ask about that later, so I'll hold fire till you do.
That's great. What you're saying is that that you can get kind of close.
What I've noticed over the last 5 or 10 years is we used to have zero competition in Sydney.
Yep.
Now every shop has a system in place, and what I'm finding now is the people that get here on average are worse functionally than was the case 10 years ago.
Right.
Because the people that don't have major issues don't get as far as us. Someone sorts them out in the local bike shop or the local bike fitter. But the people with issues, they still get here, but they get here by a more circuitous route with a few stops along the way.
Right, okay. So you see the progression is that you see a percentage of people that are going through that systematised approach and they get a tick in the box, and that generally would work.
Well, that works for them to the point in the sense that they don't perceive themselves as having a problem. So to them, it's a result.
Yeah. And then there's a percentage for those that obviously still haven't found that to be satisfactory, and they'll...
And they're looking elsewhere.
Looking elsewhere, and they eventually find you.
And we get them at the second or third or fourth attempt.
And the sort of results that you get from that, obviously...
Oh, look, Dave, I don't have unhappy customers. Yeah. It's pretty simple. I will do whatever it takes to make that person happy. Why? Because if I don't, I have to give them their money back.
That's
a very powerful incentive, and it's taught me some very hard lessons.
And I know, certainly in my experience, you know, the amount of detail that you went into was phenomenal when I originally got my first bike fit. And that would have been back in 2000. So we're talking...
Yeah, I've come away since then.
14 years. And the interesting thing is that it hasn't stopped. Every time that I've come back, you've been playing around and researching...
Well, learning's an ongoing process.
You know, and it has been an ongoing process. And I've seen... Not only you take whatever you've been doing, which has really been, for me, head and shoulders above what everybody else is doing. You know, people are still running around with formulas and, you know, this sort of stuff. And you took that to a whole new level. And every time I come back, it's like, you know, suddenly you've taken it to the next level.
I'm a curious person. I like to find answers.
you know, I think that's great. You know, I think, I mean, personally, look, I believe that without obviously being fit by everybody on the planet, I would believe that you're probably one of the top bike fitters.
Oh, no.
Certainly, and look, I don't know either. Certainly within Australia, possibly the world, one of the top.
Well, look, I think there's a dearth of information out there because my inbox is filled with bike fitters from all over the planet asking questions. So the fact they have to email someone at the other end of the world suggests to me that there's not a lot of quality info out there, because with the access to the net that everyone has, there's plenty of info there if you want it, but people aren't getting the results they want using that information, so they're looking elsewhere. And I seem to have a somewhat different view to how humans relate to bikes to most.
So let's come back to that distinction that you made around function versus, what was it?
Oh, just quantity of movement.
Quality of movement.
I'll give you an example. A lot of the people I see who've been through system fits, the one single problem that recurs time and time again is 95% plus are sitting too high.
Right. Okay.
Because the usual story is someone is stopped while they're pedalling and a joint angle measuring device called a goniometer is put on the femur and the tibia, and that angle is measured, or maybe it's done by video capture or motion capture. And the aim is to achieve a knee angle of somewhere between 135 and 145 degrees, because that's the angle where most people are pedaling through the bottom of the stroke. The problem is it depends on the quality of the person applying that information. Mm. For many, they just keep jacking the seat up, up and up till the poor old rider's pointing his toe down, plantar flexing the foot as much as the ankle will do, till they arrive at that 135, 145 degrees, and they say, there you are.
Well done. Yeah.
Now, the key thing is quality of motion, and it's easy to judge as an onlooker, and it's all about the velocity of extension of the knee. When we pedal a bike, the glutes, aided by the hamstrings, push the upper leg down. At the same time, the quads extend or straighten the lower leg. Now, the calves are also involved, but I'm trying to keep it very simple. Now, because the hamstrings are contracting while the quads are contracting, that places a limit on how fast the quads can contract. Now, when you see a sudden acceleration of the knee towards the bottom of the stroke, no matter how subtle, that's a sign that that person's nervous system has switched off their hamstrings as a self-protection measure, so the quads are no longer strained and that rate of extension of the knee increases. What it means is they've lost control of the motion.
Right.
Now, we can get away with sitting too high on the flat because momentum carries you through the dead part in the stroke. But once you hit a hill, it usually becomes painfully obvious to onlookers, if not the person riding the bike, if someone's seat is too high.
Yeah.
My best story is a shop in Melbourne whose name I won't mention. There's an ant trail of customers who've been fitted there who've come up here, and I'm used to seeing them now, and I know their seats are going to be too high.
Yeah.
So a guy walks through the door, he tells me he'd been fitted by this particular business, and I said, oh, your seat will be too high, and he said, oh, yeah, probably. He got on the bike, and I said, mate, your seat is way too high, and he said, how much? And I said, oh, easy 15, 20 mil, and he said, I've already lowered it 35 from where they had it.
Really?
I said, you're kidding. So he left here approximately 50 mil lower than apparently his original position.
Right.
And 15 or 16 mil lower than when he walked in the door.
Yeah.
That's the sort of thing I see a lot. And now I'm not trying to tip a bucket on the rest of the bike fitting world. No one more than me understands how tough a job it can be, because I had to start from scratch and work out a whole lot of stuff by myself, because I didn't use the internet till about 7 or 8 years ago. I didn't even use a computer. So I didn't have access to a lot of the information that's freely available now. But because I'm interested and do work on a money back and not happy basis, and I'm not trying to push that as a marketing line. I'm pushing it as a learning tool. Because once you're forced to hand over the cash, you learn, and you don't forget those lessons.
Yeah.
And what matters is that the result. That's all that matters. The process doesn't matter. How it was achieved, the tooling, none of that matters. The only thing that matters is you have a happy bike rider that performs better than before they saw you.
Fantastic. So coming back to that whole seat height thing, I mean, I've always, when I do my bike fits, and look, I'm by no means an expert at doing bike fits, for me, it's really important to get to the bottom of the stroke. And I know...
Absolutely.
And from a hill climbing, because, you know, I have a background in hill climbing, it's, like, totally important. And, look, my seat is probably lower than what would be considered normal. And
I suspect mine is too, but it works.
Yeah, but the fantastic thing is that I can at least climb, and I can, because you know, like I very simply think of it as that if you're having to reach to get to the bottom of the stroke, then you're having to unstabilize.
You're destabilizing your pelvis. Yeah. You're being forced to enlist upper body effort in an effort to regain stability. The problem, as soon as you, as soon as there's any unnecessary tension in the upper body, you hinder breathing efficiency, and so on and so on. Yeah. Now, people who can't get here or don't want to come here or live in other parts of the planet often say to me, "How do I determine my seat height?" I just tell them to keep riding up a hill. Now, if they can get to the top of the hill feeling like their weight is evenly supported between the left and right sides of their seat, if they feel like both feet are reaching fluently through the bottom of the stroke, keep repeating that hill, moving the seat up 3 millimetres at a time. Once they realise they've gone too far, drop it not only the last 3 mil increment, drop it another couple of mil as well.
Right. Yeah.
Just so they've got a margin for error. If they feel on the first repetition that they're sitting too high, their weight's not evenly distributed on the seat, keep repeating that hill, dropping the seat 3 millimetres at a time. Now, it helps when you're doing that if you force the gear a bit.
Yeah.
That is, ride approximately one gear higher than you can comfortably ride up that hill. Why? Because what matters is what we do under load.
Yeah.
So you're trying to ride up that like you are racing it.
Yeah, exactly. Now, I mean, we're talking about a fairly high torque, what I would call a high
absolutely.
Torque.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Now,
and why up a hill? Sorry, just to interrupt.
Yeah.
Why up a hill? Because up a hill, everyone relative to their normal pedaling technique drops their heels more.
Of course they do.
Because they're trying to get behind that pedal as early as possible in the stroke.
Yeah.
Now, when we drop our heels, our legs extend more.
Yeah. And when I'm teaching people how to pedal properly, you know, the first thing I ask them to do is stabilise their hips. And imagine their hips are nice and stable. So once they've got that happening, then we start working on pedaling over the top and the bottom of the stroke. For them to be able to do that, they've got to stabilise their core. They can't do it.
You've got to be able to sit reasonably squarely on the seat.
Yeah, you can't, you know.
And you want to achieve that stability passively. You don't want to be using muscular effort to be stable on a bike, which means the rider themselves has to be reasonably functional. I mean, everyone's out there trying to condition themselves for cycling in a cardiovascular sense, but you also have to condition yourself to hold that position for the length of time you've got to do it. And anyone who rides a bike and doesn't stretch regularly has got their priorities wrong.
Yeah. Totally agree, yeah. The interesting thing is that when people come to my studio and I start working through this exercise, it's not uncommon for them to only be able to hold it for like 30 or 40 seconds.
You got it.
And I think a lot of that comes from the fact that, you know, they're very much disbound and not very functional.
Most people sit too much. Most people don't realise how dysfunctional they are.
Yeah.
I've got a simple series of stability exercises I put people through. My feeling is anyone who wants to ride a bike should be able to nail those 7 compound movements with ease. And I don't think that's the height of athletic achievement. I think that's the bare minimum requirement. I would get maybe one person a year out of 300 to 500 who can do that.
Yeah, wow.
Because most of us sit on a... We think about our body when it hurts. We assume if there's no pain, there's no problem.
Yeah.
Pain's a long way along the dysfunction spectrum. Pain comes when your body's run out of ways to compensate. Pain's not an early warning sign, it's a late warning sign.
Right. Yeah. Do you think that's that lifestyle, like I know cyclists historically have come from more of a tradie type background, and nowadays we get seeing a lot more people that are disbanded.
Yeah,
do you think
cycling really has historically been a working class sport, and the funny thing is, 20 years ago, if you were a lifetime cyclist, you were a social outcast, you were counterculture, you were a bit strange, because there weren't many adults riding bikes. I can remember around that period being at a barbecue on a summer's day and I was wearing shorts and a singlet or a t-shirt or something, and another guy there looked me up and down and said, "Oh, you look pretty fit, what do you do?" And I said, I race bikes. He said, "Push bikes?" I said, "Yeah." And he looked me up and down and he said, "But you're an adult. Like, why would you use a kid's toy?" Whereas now cycling's a widespread activity. A lot of... Most cyclists now are taking up the sport at between 35 and 50. They are not in the first bloom of youth. They've sat behind a desk for the last 10, 15, 20 years, and it shows. People need to unwind the postural distortions they get by having desk-bound jobs and failing to resist gravity. That's one of my favourite subjects.
Yeah.
Good posture is posture that resists gravity. Why is good posture necessary? Because posture and alignment determines how well your nervous system works. And as I mentioned earlier, good nervous system function is a precondition of good biomechanical function. What's the single thing we can do to influence nervous system efficiency? Stand tall, sit tall, carry yourself well. Gravity's omnipresent. We forget it exists because it pushes down on us 24 hours a day, and it pushes us into our own personal version of postural dysfunction. If you want a cue, put your finger on your sternal notch, your wishbone, and lift it. As soon as you do that and extend your spine and elevate your rib cage, you hollow your abdomen and create intra-abdominal pressure. In other words, you squash your viscera, your guts. That pressure is the majority of support for the lumbar spine, because the cervical, the thoracic and the sacral spine have direct muscular and skeletal support. The lumbar spine relies almost wholly on indirect support, which we call core strength, a word that I dislike, or good posture, because they're one and the same. And the best core exercise you can do is merely stand tall and sit tall.
Well, I
saw you sit tall.
We all do, because it's
the hardest thing to forget.
Yeah.
So, you know, we need a prompt. I mean, there's a little gizmo I saw on the net a while back called an eye posture. I've ordered one for my wife who has back problems. And what it is a little lapel badge or necklace with some sort of device in it that measures the relationship to horizontal. So if you bend forward more than a few degrees, it starts bipping at you unless your torso is straight. Now, it hasn't arrived yet, so I'm not sure how well it will work, but it seemed like a good idea to me.
It's beautiful.
So hopefully we'll be surrounded in the future by people bipping all the time when they let go of their posture.
Well, that'd be fantastic. I know since moving to Mansfield, one of the priorities in our office space was that I wanted a stand-up desk. I wanted a desk that I could stand up instead of... And I got into a bad habit because when I'm in the desk...
We all do this. Look, humans do this all day. We flex our spines. When do we ever do this?
Yeah.
We don't.
So we've talked a little bit about seat height.
Mm-hmm.
Let's talk about cleat position and foot correctness, because I know that you spend a lot of time on this, like a huge amount of time.
Well, look, without going into a lot of detail, because I have patent applications in that have been approved in the US, the UK and New Zealand, but not yet in Australia.
Right.
So I can only talk in very general terms, not specific terms. And I'd best start at the start. I don't know if whoever's watching this knows what proprioception is, so I'd better start right at the start.
Right.
When we walk across a room or ride a bike or commit to any other form of physical activity, it is a conscious thought that starts that process. What is unconscious is the muscle firing pattern we use to accomplish the task. I mean, no one walks down the street thinking, if I tense this muscle and loosen this muscle, we just think I'm going to walk.
Yeah.
Well, your cerebellum, which is the seat of most unconscious motor control, your cerebellum is the part of the brain that works out the muscle firing sequence that allows you to accomplish this task. So a conscious thought triggers the event, but after that it's all unconscious. And supposedly something like 97% of our daily activity is unconscious. Now, proprioception is merely the cerebellum's awareness of what the body is doing in space. Now, it gains that awareness from the output of hundreds of millions of sensory nerves called proprioceptors that are distributed throughout the body. But they are not distributed evenly. 50% of those receptors are in and around the upper and lower jaw. So 50% of the awareness that each of us is generating now from internal sources about what we're doing sitting on these chairs comes from here. And you might remember the story about your jaw alignment.
Yeah,
that's why it played a part.
Yeah.
Another 25 to 30% of those receptors are located in and around our sacroiliac joints, where the sacrum, the five bony fused vertebrae at the base of the spine, butts up against the pelvis. The remaining 20-25% of those receptors are in every bone, muscle, ligament, tendon and joint. Between them, they convey a constant flow of information, something like 3 billion signals a second, to the spine and up the spine to the cerebellum, alerting it to the load each body part's undergoing, where that body part is in space, and how that body part relates to gravity. We use that total flow of information to coordinate our actions. It sounds like a great system, and it is, but the flaw in the system, and it's not a flaw, it's as much a filter and self-protection mechanism as anything, is that while we generate 3 billion signals per second, and they all get through, we can only process 2,000.
Right.
So once I read those numbers, whenever it was, it became my interest in trying to work out what hierarchy of priorities evolution had dictated we place on what we choose to prioritise for processing and what we choose to ignore. And to simplify it a bit, the best analogy I've got is if you're sitting, you and Jody are sitting at a sporting match.
Sure.
There's 100,000 people there, but you two are intent upon a conversation with each other. So even though you're focused on that conversation, you're still in a general sense aware of all those screaming thousands of people, but you're not paying attention.
Yeah.
Well, I'll multiply that situation by orders of magnitude, and that's the cerebellum situation. So what I've worked out through trial and error and a lot of painstaking work is the cerebellum only chooses to prioritise two categories of stimulus.
Right. Yep.
The first is any time we exert ourselves. Because any time we exert ourselves, that's taken on as a priority task, not just by the cerebellum, but by the whole central nervous system, because it's got obvious survival value. In an evolutionary sense, if you're running for your life or fighting for your life, you are betting your life literally that you're going to coordinate those actions as well as humanly possible. Because like every other organism on the planet, your first priority is survival.
Yeah.
And you'll do whatever you have to do that. Now, within that category, force generated from the top of the pelvis down is given a higher priority than force generated from the top of the pelvis up. And again, there's an evolutionary imperative at work. We've evolved to be upright creatures who relate to planet Earth through our feet. There's no evolutionary mileage whatsoever, given the disparity between processing capacity and signal output, in only being able to use your arms, bend your torso or nod your head if concurrently that means buckling at the hips, knees and ankles. So pelvis down gets first call on our proprioceptive awareness because that's what holds us upright. That's our postural foundation. Upper body gets second call. The other category of stimulus that will always gain the cerebellum's attention is any change in the quality of stimulus. A whisper that's being ignored can quickly be elevated into a shout that's being processed if there's a change. And a simple example is if I do that, you become more aware of that part of your upper arm and your clothing than you were 5 or 10 seconds previously.
Yeah.
But that increased awareness only lasts a few seconds before your attention drifts off onto other things.
Yeah.
And in fact, in a serial sense, that's what's happening constantly. The cerebellum doesn't remain focused on the same 2,000 bits of information. Its attention is constantly flitting around. Is that important? No, I can ignore that. Is that important? No, I can ignore that. Oh, that's important. I better stay focused on that. And so on and so on. Now, as part of this, I better tell you that in a proprioceptive sense, on a bicycle, no one knows what their feet are doing. We don't know, because we compensate so well with feedback from hips, knees and ankles that we're not aware of it. But compensating never solves a problem. It only shifts the load. And in this case, it involves, and always involves a cost. In this case, a dual cost. The first is an increased tendency to left-right asymmetry. Because any challenge to our position in space from any source whatsoever, too high seat heights, one, having a short legs, another, not having clear proprioceptive awareness of what your feet's doing is a third, and there's a million others, but any challenge to our position in space will cause us to automatically compensate. That's what our nervous system is incredibly adept at doing. But all of our compensatory responses increase the difference between left and right side function. Now, that's a bit of an issue because a bike is a symmetrical apparatus in a positional sense.
Yeah.
And to give you a simple example, we're talking about seat height.
Yep.
If someone's seat height is jacked up too high, it's an exceptionally rare person who'll sit squarely on the seat and equally overextend both legs. What they will do at an unconscious level is their nervous system will pick a leg to look after, which is almost always but not always the right leg, and a leg to sacrifice, which is almost always but not always the left leg. Now, how that manifests is that person will start dropping or rolling their right hip forward, which causes the left leg to overextend and also challenges the plane of motion of the left hip, knee and ankle constantly.
Yeah.
That's just one example. So bike fitting, in a sense, is all about getting rid of challenges to our position in space, decompensating people so they don't have to compensate. Now, where foot correction comes in is, when I said any change in the quality of stimulus will always attract the cerebellum's attention, what most people watching this won't realise is when the muscles of our legs fire, whether we walk, run, hop, skip or whatever, while the cerebellum oversees the task, the basic pattern of extensor on, flexor off, flexor on, extensor off is not generated up here. It's overseen by the cerebellum. The actual on and off switching is conducted by a bundle of neurons in the lumbar spine called a central pattern generator. Now, the central pattern generator uses as its informational input force feedback from the feet. Now, when we walk and run, our feet flex a lot. They change shape on heel strike, toe off, and so on. And arch tension changes a lot. Now, arch tension is a primary component of that force feedback from the feet that is recognised by the CPG. In contrast to walking and running, when we're pushing on a rigid-soled cycling shoe, arch tension changes little, if at all.
Mm.
So the central nervous system tends to switch off to that. So the feet tend to be like this proprioceptive void or black hole. Yeah. Now, I can demonstrate, and you've seen me do it, but I'm not going to tell you how because it's still undergoing the patent process, that everyone knows what their hips, knees and ankles are doing, but no one knows what their feet are doing. And to wake up that connection, we need a decent level of arch support and, in most cases, some wedging as well. But even then, if wedging is needed, and usually is but not always, it has to be in the correct location. It has to be either cleat wedging or heel wedging. Or sometimes a mixture of both, but you can't just generically wedge. Even if it's the right number, the nervous system will switch off to that feedback after a period. I think I got off the track there, so you've got to get me back on track.
No, you've done really well. And it's actually phenomenal because I know that the last bike fit that I got with you, we went through and addressed that particular issue. And I know when I got back onto the bike and when I was riding down Beach Road, it was just like...
You felt solid and stable.
I just felt like solid and stable. Like I couldn't get over how different that felt from being able to apply pressure to the pedals. And that the feet felt just really comfortable.
Well, it's all about creating a situation where that connection between the motor control centres of the brain and the feet is open and being prioritised at all times. Now, think of it like this. Imagine your cerebellum is staring at a wall with 1.5 million white diodes on it, and only one of those diodes is the feet. How does it know which one's the feet? The cerebellum is constantly using up a large percentage of what is quite limited processing capacity, constantly chasing information as to what the feet's doing. Now, once that connection's established, that capacity is freed up and allows the rider to better coordinate the entire task of cycling, and that's what you were feeling. You just had more neural capacity available to do the job because there was a clear and loud connection between feet and cerebellum.
Yeah, just incredible.
Well, it's been a bit of fun. Took me a long time to work out.
But, you know, the results from it are just a huge, I wouldn't say improvement, because I can't quantify that.
Some people can. There's a lot of people coming here with power meters, and I'm used to getting emails like I'm putting out 6 to 7% more power at the same heart rate and this sort of thing. Because it's not magic. It's not that they've brought more muscle to the task. It's they're using less effort to stabilise themselves. And that makes that effort available to push the pedals rather than hold a position.
Oh, yeah. You know, and it always comes back. Matt Brindle said to me one day, he said, you can only generate as much power as you can stabilise.
That's absolutely right. Absolutely right.
Yeah. If you can't stabilise it...
And ideally, you should be stable on the bike and relaxed while you do it. Yeah. A good position requires a functional human being, and they're in short supply, but we can all be a work in progress, and we're allowed to be a work in progress as long as an emphasis on progress.
Yeah.
We need a functional human being, and with a good position, riding a bike should feel easy.
Yeah.
It should feel easy.
Well, yeah, I mean, riding a bike for me has always felt a lot easier than running.
I mean, you can't do anything about the huff and puff of exertion, but the mere act of holding a position while you apply force to the pedals should feel easy. It shouldn't feel like hard work.
Now, look, I get a lot of people that come in, and just to move off that onto another topic, and they're not a person that can get down to the drops. You know, like when they're riding on the bike, they complain of neck and shoulder soreness. And
well, there's a host of reasons for that, and lack of flexibility might be one of them, but seat placement and cleat position play a big part in that as well, because they're the components that make the rider stable or unstable. But let's assume they've got a decent seat position, a decent cleat position, their foot correction's ideal, and they can't reach the drops. The drops have to come to where they can reach them. There's no point having them if you can't use them.
Yeah.
I mean, I go down to Centennial Park and I see people riding around with dirty bar tape on top and shiny bar tape below. They may as well take a hacksaw and cut immediately below the brake hoods because they wouldn't lose anything. The drops have to be where the rider can comfortably reach them. That doesn't mean that they have to spend time down there. I don't care, but I want it to be available to them as a comfortable option. Now, for some people that's low, for some people that's high, for most it's somewhere in between. I mean, you've seen me, I ride with my seat up here and my bars down there because I'm flexible enough and functional enough to do it. But I wasn't always like that. I had to work for that.
Yeah. Certainly an area that I'm always having to correct myself and work on. I just remember that. You know, massage.
Hip flexibility, lower back flexibility. I don't mean lower back ability to bend your lumbar spine. You don't want to flex your lumbar spine. You want to bend at the hip. That takes glutes and hamstrings and quadratus lumborum that are flexible. So get onto Kit Lachlan's YouTube channel.
Yeah.
It's the best free resource out there for anyone who wants to stretch.
Yeah, fantastic. So we've talked about pedal stroke, and we've talked about seat height. We've talked about handlebar position. Is there anything that we haven't really covered that you think is quite important to bike fitting?
Seat setback. Right. I mean, the old LORE is a plumb line drop from there, must bisect the pedal axle. I've never understood that, because what that's in effect saying is the relationship of one limb segment to the pedal axle is so overwhelmingly important that it outweighs any whole of body considerations. And when you put it in those terms, it sounds like a nonsense, because frankly it is. So I look at everything through a neurological filter.
Right.
Seat setback, once you've got a decent seat height, should be the minimum setback that allows the rider to largely cantilever their upper body out from the seat with minimum effort invested in the handlebars. You should be a fraction forward of your centre of gravity. You should need your arms to support your weight, but only just need your arms. The more pressure you've got on the pedals, the more your upper body should be unweighted. So if you're tootling around at 25-30k an hour, yes, there should be some weight on your hands. But when you're riding at 45-50k an hour flat out, your upper body should be literally weightless. The pressure you're putting on the pedals should be supporting your upper body.
Yeah.
Now, if you can't do that, either there's a problem with your position or there's a problem with how you function. And for many people, it's how they function.
Yeah, I understand. So let's talk about triathlon or triathlete type time trial positions.
Well, triathlon position and time trial position are not the same thing.
Yeah.
A triathlon, particularly an Ironman, is not a time trial in the sense that a road time trial
is. Well, I agree
with you. If you go past 4 millimoles of lactate, you're not going to run very well. So an Ironman is not a time trial, though it's marketed like it's a time trial. It's a 75% effort time trial, because if you go much harder than that, you're not going to run very well.
Yeah.
So the requirements are different. Whereas a road time trial, if you get off the bike and can walk, you're looked upon as a soft cock. Yeah, you've got to leave it all out there.
Yeah.
So look, comfort always has a time value attached to it. So what is comfortable for an Olympic distance triathlon in terms of bar height may not be comfortable for an Ironman. I mean, if you want a rule of thumb, and I hate rules of thumb, but if you're an Olympic distance triathlete and contemplating a half Ironman or an Ironman, and you're happy with your position, lift your bars 20 mil. Because it's a long day out.
Yeah.
It's a long day out. And go to any triathlon, particularly if it's one where the bike leg is two or three laps and you get to see people come past multiple times. At the old Foster Ironman, which is 290K laps, it was wonderful. You'd see people come past after 90K looking like they were a wind tunnel study. The second lap, they'd be sitting up on top of the bars like this, and guess what? They weren't going any slower because they'd set themselves positions they could not maintain.
Yeah.
And you see that in any tri conducted in tough conditions with headwinds or side winds, you'll see a lot of people cannot maintain an aero position. So
that's
the position,
for that
I'm all for aerodynamics, but aerodynamics has been used to tap into the unspoken wish we all have to get something for nothing. And the message pushed by the marketing guys who are pretty cluey is just spend money, get more aero. You don't have to train harder, just get more aero.
Yeah.
Aerodynamics is one of the components of performance, but frankly, it's the least important. If you sacrifice 1 watt of power or 1 watt of comfort being more aerodynamic, you're going to go slower, not faster.
Right. Okay.
So it's got to be sensible.
Yeah.
It's got to be achievable. You can sit further forward on a tri bike or a TT bike because you've got four major joints. You don't have to worry about stabilising.
Yeah.
On a road bike, you've got to stabilise wrists and elbows. On a tri bike, they're inherently stable because you've got the cup, so you can come further forward. I just think many people overdo it. And I see the casualties here.
Yeah. I mean, I had a guy come in that had been set up by somebody and he was that far forward on the bottom bracket. I don't know how you could ride the bike.
Well, the problem is many of them don't breathe very well when the position's ridiculous. Mm. And the other thing is they can't see where they're going.
Yeah.
Yeah, so they ride like this. And you shouldn't have to risk crashing to ride fast.
Yeah.
Because you can only look up once every 30 metres.
Yeah. Yeah. So just wanted to recap on everything that we've talked about, and we've finished up talking about time trial positions.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay.
So. Yeah, well, time trial position. Well, if you want to, again, I'll talk about rules of thumb, and there are plenty of exceptions to this. So this is not the gospel, this is not graven in stone. Yeah. If you have a road bike and you're happy with your position and you feel you're strong, you're stable, you're comfortable, and you want to know how to set up a TT bike, move your seat forward somewhere between 10 and 15 mil. That will allow you to roll your pelvis further forward and flatten your back. Now, as you do that, your hip moves up and back as the pelvis rolls forward. So while pedaling mechanics change, they don't change massively. Then set your bars where you can comfortably reach them. If in doubt as to your position, go out and do a 20K TT. If you can maintain that position for 20K at high intensity, it's probably a good position.
Yeah.
If you can't, it's not.
Yeah.
If you're struggling to maintain that position, you're getting pressure around the neck and shoulders or anything like that, now you've got work to do.
Now, so we talked a little bit about road setup and how it collates into time trialing. Mm. What about track? Track.
Well, you've got to talk about sprinting on its own. That's totally another world.
All right. Well, let's talk about track.
Most people who are doing general track events. I mean, the kind of guy who goes to club track carnivals and races every event or most events, his position shouldn't be a whole lot different from his road position.
Right.
His bars can be a little lower because he's not on the bike for as long a period, and comfort, as I said, always comes with a time value. What's comfortable for a 12-lapper may be uncomfortable for a, you know, a three-hour road race. So you can get away with lower bars. Seat a little bit further forward, you know, again, 5, 10, 15 mil, because you can pedal faster. And there's no hills on the track. And it's a fixed wheel, and that's the thing that's often overlooked. On the track, once you have momentum, once that bike is up and going, the forward motion of the bike carries you through the dead spot. So you can get away with things you can't do on a road bike.
Yeah.
And as you probably know, you can ride up a hill on a fixed wheel faster, in a bigger gear than you can ride up that same hill on a free wheel.
Yeah, of course you can.
Because the forward motion of the bike carries you through the dead spot, which it doesn't quite do when you've got a free wheel.
There's no hiding on a hill.
Yeah, there isn't.
Yep.
So a track bike, an evolution of the road position, it shouldn't be massively different.
Yep.
Lower bars, seat a little bit further forward, but only within the bounds of comfort.
Mm-hmm. It's been fascinating, Steve.
All right, good to see you again.
Yeah, it's been fantastic. Thank you very much for taking the time out.
That's all right. Thank you all for watching.
Excellent.